Good afternoon, Dr. William Fong, Treasurer Ms. Rosanna Choi, Professor Clayton McKenzie, Professor Edward Snape, honorable guests and fellow students. It is my greatest pleasure to welcome you all to this public lecture on managing change in a radically disrupted world to be delivered by Dr. William Fong, SBS OBE JP, recipient of honorary degree of Doctor of Business Administration 2017. My name is Natalie Falk. I'm a year 5 student majoring in translation, and I'm very honored to be your MC today. Every year, the university will confer honorary doctoral degree on distinguished persons for their outstanding academic, research, arts, or professional achievements, as well as remarkable contributions to the society. The Brilliance of Civilization program is organized for the honorary doctorate recipients to share their life experiences and distinguished professional knowledge with the university community and the general public. To begin with, may I now invite Professor Clayton McKenzie, Provost, to deliver his welcoming remarks. Professor McKenzie, please.
Dr. William Fong, members and friends of Dr. Fong's family, Ms. Rosanna Choi, members of the University Council and Court, distinguished guests, colleagues, students. On behalf of the Hong Kong Baptist University, I extend our warmest welcome to you all. And here I must convey my very best wishes and warm congratulations to Dr. Fong for being conferred an honorary degree of Doctor of Business Administration at the 58th commencement, held on the 13th of November 2017, for his significant accomplishments in the business field and remarkable contributions to society. Today, the university is honored to have Dr. William Fong sharing on the topic of managing change in a radically disrupted world. This lecture is part of the Brilliance of Civilization series, which enables our students and the wider community to have a close encounter with inspirational role models, benefit from their words of wisdom, and be instilled with their vision of how to contribute to society. A preeminent entrepreneur and business leader, Dr. William Fong is best known for his contribution to the development of Hong Kong as a leading international trading hub, and for his outstanding public service in trade promotion and economic development. At present, Dr. Fong is the group chairman of the Li & Fung, chairman of the Global Brands Group Holding Limited, and group deputy chairman of the Fong Group of Companies. In addition, he has served as chairman of the Hong Kong General Chamber of Commerce, the Hong Kong Exporters Association, and the Hong Kong Committee for Pacific Economic Cooperation Council. In addition to his professional achievements, Dr. Fong demonstrates strong care about society and gives unstinting support to higher education, as well as research. Through his family foundations, which include the Fung Hong Chu Foundation Limited, Fung 1906 Foundation Limited, and the Victor and William Fung Foundation Limited, Dr. Fong and his family have made substantial contributions to a wide variety of meaningful causes, including those of HKBU. As we all know, Dr. Fong has been our long-standing friend who has supported multiple initiatives of the university over the years. To name just a couple, HKBU established the Fung Hong Chu Endowed Chair in Humanics in 2006 to uphold its mission of whole person education and cultivate all-round talents for the benefit of society. And in 2012, a service leadership education project was launched to nurture our undergraduate students to be good service leaders. Once again, we must thank Dr. William Fong for his generosity in sharing his valuable insights with us today. According to the ancient Greek philosopher Heraclitus, the only thing that is constant is change. What has worked well for us today may not be the best approach tomorrow. So, are you equipped for the complexities of a highly turbulent environment? A Chinese proverb says, "A wise man adapts himself to circumstances, as water shapes itself to the vessel that contains it." In understanding Dr. Fung's proven strategies in managing change, I'm sure we can find inspiration to cope with and thrive in the age of change and radical disruption. Thank you.
May I now invite Professor Edward Snape, Dean of School of Business, to introduce today's speaker, Dr. William Fung, to us. Professor Snape, please.
Dr. Fung, honourable guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to HKBU. If you are an old friend, welcome back. I am very pleased to be here today to have the chance to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. William Fung, Group Chairman of Lian Fung. Dr. Fung graduated from Princeton University, I won't say in what year, with a BSc degree in engineering, and he also has an MBA from Harvard Graduate School of Business. One of the key achievements, I think, of Dr. Fung's business career is that he's successfully transformed what had been a relatively traditional trading company founded by his grandfather in Guangzhou back in 1906 into the world's leading supply chain solutions partner for retailers and brands worldwide. So that is a really fundamental and major transformation, I think a very great achievement. Today, Lian Fung operates an extensive global supply chain network employing just Lian Fung, over 21,000 people in 250 offices and distribution centers around the world. The company works, I mean, this is an amazing figure. The company works with a vendor base of well over 15,000 different suppliers. So you can see the scale of the operation here. Now then, the global retail industry is now undergoing profound changes driven by disruptive technologies and also by shifting customer preferences. It's not just a technology story. And Dr. Fung has been instrumental in leading his company through this period of monumental change. I think the key to his success has been the ability, an ability to quickly develop supply chain solutions for customers in real time almost, as new situations emerge. And he's now focused on creating the supply chain of the future. A digitalized supply chain that delivers with speed, that fosters innovation, and that generates valuable business insights. For his outstanding entrepreneurship, Dr. Fung has received a number of accolades, a large number of accolades and awards. I'll mention a few of them, just to give a flavor for that. Back in 1995, he was voted as one of the world's top 25 managers. That's an interesting stat. One of the 50 stars of Asia in year 2000 by Business Week. And Businessman of the Year by Forbes magazine in 2006. Dr. Fung was awarded the Silver Bohemia Star by the Hong Kong SAR government in 2008 for his work on trade promotion and economic development. So you can get a flavour for the kind of awards. Looking more locally, very locally, Dr. Fung has been a strong supporter of Hong Kong Baptist U. Our provost has already mentioned a couple of items, the endowed chair in humanics, the Fung scholarships, the Fung Service Leadership Initiative. One of the things I note in those is that there's kind of a common link in them, in that they are very much, they resonate with this university's tradition of whole person education, educating the person in the round. And I think that's an important theme. In recognition of Dr. Fung's outstanding achievements and contribution to society, the university conferred on him the degree of Doctor of Business Administration, honoris causa, at its 58th commencement in November of last year, 2017. Today's public lecture comes out of that award. It's basically this series of lectures, The Brilliance of Civilization, is organized by the university to celebrate the conferment of honorary doctoral degrees. This afternoon, Dr. Fung will speak on what promises to be, I think, an intriguing topic, managing change in a radically disrupted world. Hence my introduction, trying to make a link there. So, could you please join with me in giving a very warm welcome to Dr. William Fung.
Before I start, let me just first also thank the university for giving me the great honor of conferring on me the doctorate degree, the honorary doctorate degree. As I said to Professor Snape when I just came in, it's kind of daunting for me to talk in this university in front of all the professors here. The Chinese would definitely call this ban wen long fu. And looking at the audience, maybe I should have thought about doing my address in Chinese, except that, of course, a lot of the words, unfortunately, that's being used now have only some Chinese equivalent and some not. Let me try to preface my remarks this way. Okay, I think that as I was searching, you know, in this series and to talk about something, I was really looking for something that would be more universal, rather than just a very dry, you know, supply chain theory kind of thing. And frankly, I think that today we probably lived in a more disrupted world than we really have been, at least in my lifetime. And last year, or this year actually, I just received the 45th anniversary medal from the company, from Li & Fung, for serving 45 years, so I am an old guy. And Professor Snape was asked saying that, a lot of our speakers now come in jeans and no tie and open shirt. And I thought about doing that, except that it won't look good against my white hair, and I'm pretending to be something I'm not. So please, when I talk about the disruptions today, I can speak probably more authoritatively about the disruptions that I've experienced in the 45 years that I've been in business. But as I talk about the disruptions today, take it as words from an observer. The person at the front lines fighting this battle is actually my nephew, Spencer Fung, who's now the current CEO of Li & Fung. Okay, so both my brother Victor and I have been backseat driving him. And every time we say something referring back to the past, of course Spencer always say, Dad, so that's like old stuff. It's changed a lot. And I think that's indicative of the kind of change we're experiencing today. And I would say that this idea of change and managing change, affects everyone, not just businesses. I think it affects everyone. The disruption caused by this spurt of technology, and I hope to give you a reason why there's a spurt of technology right now. I have doctor friends who tell me that in the old days, consultation is very simple. The patient comes in, you give him 3 minutes, you tell him what's wrong with him, you get a prescription, you send him away. Now the patient wants to talk for half an hour about why you're wrong, because they have the internet, and they've searched everything about whatever they were suffering from before they came to the doctor. So it disrupts everybody. This technology is disrupting everyone, every profession, every business that I know. So I thought it might be appropriate to perhaps using us as the example, because we do have a long history of how companies like ours or organizations can deal with disruption. So really, my presentation is in two parts. The first part is probably a discourse of what I see happening and hopefully some insights into what I think is happening or will happen. And secondly, perhaps at least our solution, a practical solution, to how we can deal with this disruption, this wave of disruption that's coming now in a systematic way. I don't think it's good enough today just to say that, something's changed, some new technology has happened, I better do something about it. That's reacting. So I hope to share with you at the last part of my presentation some ideas of how we are dealing with it and have dealt with actually changes. Because frankly, we are not a stranger to disruption. Since the provost and the dean has given such a long presentation, I think I'll skip all the propaganda. Other than the fact that we're very proud of being at least these sustainability indices, I think that is a new trend going forward. And certainly in the Q&A, I can answer a lot about what we're doing with corporate social responsibility, CSR, with compliance and so on. Okay, let me first start by saying that let's see what happened to Li & Fung. As I said, we are no stranger to disruption and change. We really are not, because in our 112-year history, I think we've seen a lot of huge changes. If you look at if you track our company against the world, what happened in China, what happened in Hong Kong, and what happened to us. You remember the world, it started by my grandfather, the firm in 1906. For those of you who remember the movie The Last Emperor, the last heirs of the Qing Dynasty, that's when our company started, and that's when he started. His only claim to fame was that he could speak English, and therefore he could deal with the Western buyers who come in to try to buy Chinese handicrafts. We didn't deal in agricultural products, okay, but in handicrafts. Okay, and that's what China did. It was the beginning of China trade. Everyone here would know about the tea trade. Everyone would know that, you know, some of the most desirable commodities from China were tea, porcelain, silk, and so on. Okay, the only thing the China trade that the family did not deal with, and I'm sort of proud to say, was opium. We did not deal in opium. Okay, but having said that, okay, that was what China produced, and that's what the West wanted at that period. Okay, and what was Hong Kong? As you know, Hong Kong was the prize of a war, the Opium Wars. And one thing you could say about the English were that they are great sailors. So they found the best deep water port in the South China coast, and that's Hong Kong. And this was the colony for 150 years. We were a colony of England. And it acted as the entrepot for China during this period up till 1949. Okay, and it's the best deep water port. And the first generation of Fungs, namely my grandfather, who started the company, we were based actually in Canton. Okay, which is interesting because in the subsequent period of isolation, everything in terms of contact with the West was conducted through something called the Canton Fair at that time. Okay, Canton was a traditional base for Chinese exposure to the rest of the world, and actually the Chinese government at that time, both the emperor and later the government and then later the People's Republic, confined the contact with the West to basically Canton. But Hong Kong was always the port. And in 1949, there was a huge change. Now, talk about disruption. That was a disruption. Like many other families, you know, our family lost everything in China. My father at that time, who was head of the company, came down to Hong Kong, and he started all over again, like many, I'm sure many of the families, if you're from Hong Kong, experienced the same thing. That was a complete disruption. So what happened in the next period, then I'll go into more substantive details. Okay, for some strange reason, by the way, I've been looking at it, and it struck me. You know, we have a theory that China somehow changes in cycles of 30 years. 1949, the founding of the People's Republic of China, to 1979, when Deng Xiaoping opened up China, exactly 30 years. Okay, China changed completely. But this was a period where the world was actually thriving because it was a post-Second World War reconstruction. You know, there was trade and everything became very important in the world. Okay, and so against this background, though, China basically went into isolation. So in these 30 years, there was no China, really. China trade, as I said earlier, was confined to the Canton Fair. Even our company, which was always dealt in Chinese goods, went twice a year up to Canton and did our trade, you know, with Chinese suppliers at that time. So really restricted. And Hong Kong was in a dire situation, just as our firm was. Okay, Hong Kong basically lost its role as entrepot to China. So what did Hong Kong do? Hong Kong survived by changing. Okay, and that managed that change very well. They were aided by the fact that because of the change in China, there was a flood of refugees and therefore labor that came to Hong Kong. And for those of you who remember, okay, this was the period where Hong Kong actually industrialized. And we exported, we manufactured and exported. In fact, you know, our richest man, Mr. Lee Ka-shing, started life in Hong Kong as a plastic flower manufacturer before he very wisely turned to real estate, which we didn't do, unfortunately, as a family. I keep telling my father, you know, why can't you be as smart as Mr. Lee? if you had only gone into property, I wouldn't have to work for a living anymore today. And then he told me, he says, William Victor, you know what? I said the same thing to my father. He said to my grandfather, if only you were smart enough to do opium, he doesn't have the wealth for a living anymore. So that's the problem that we have. But it became a manufacturing center of the labor-intensive types of consumer goods that Li & Fung is still dealing on today. So in a way, and we also have the handicraft. In fact, one of our exports is still fireworks from China. So in a way, I think our company can claim a line really from 1906 to now in terms of what we're doing, instead of switching into different industries, which we probably should have done, but we didn't. So I think it gives us a certain perspective on the change and how you deal with change, and that is really what I will talk about. Well, in the next period, what happened was that there was a mass globalization. This is the migration of manufacturing. If you take something like shoes or apparel, you know, and Kenneth will know this very well, it may have started in Massachusetts in America, then moved down to North Carolina, South Carolina, in the Deep South, and then it went overseas. Okay, all aided and abetted by the fact that transportation and other things were happening. This is the next period coming up, which is the period that I'm in. And then it came to Hong Kong first and then Taiwan. And then it went to Korea and went Southeast Asia. And now we're in Bangladesh, India. And my latest sort of new country besides Myanmar in Southeast Asia was actually a place like Ethiopia in Kenya. So what we faced in the next 30 years was really this mass migration of manufacturing. Basically, it's the arbitraging of labor costs, okay, for the whole world at that time, those 30 years. And Li Yinfeng was really in the thick of that. And we are basically, during this period, you know, we had a lot to do with it. I'll tell you my story. In 1972, when I came back to work in Hong Kong, my friends were telling me, you know, William, we don't know why you've come back to work in this business, this export of consumer goods. You know, it was garments, it was household textiles, it was, I think, plastic goods, toys, and so on. He says, you know, we're finished here. Hong Kong's finished because our labor was too expensive. Everything's gone to Taiwan. That's what they told me in the 70s. So I told my father, I talked to Victor, and I said, okay, let's go to Taiwan. Let's follow the production. The thing that stuck in my mind was that 6 months after I moved the production to Taiwan, some production to Taiwan, my own new staff came to me and said that, you know, Mr. Fung, we don't know why you've come here. We finished here. Everything's gone to Korea. So we started in Korea. And then the Koreans are saying we can't compete with the Filipinos, the Thais, and so on. And guess what? In 1979, everyone threw up their arms in despair and said, how can you possibly compete with China? 1.3 billion people, all the labor, all the hands you possibly would want, you know, for manufacturing these labor-intensive goods. Well, guess what? A few years ago, I was in Shanghai talking to a factory owner. And he says, Mr. Fung, you know, it's so hard competing with the Bangladeshis and the Pakistanis. So this is the nature, this is the nature of our business. So what happened next? Well, we ended up, because of that, we ended up building a pretty globalized network. You know, really, we're in 40 countries, economies, and we're pretty much all over the place. So that was the reason, not because there's any foresight, because we were just reacting to what's happening. And I'll come back to that, because I think reacting is no longer good enough. Okay, so this is, if I look at that period, okay, which is from 1949, from 1979, after we came back forwards, okay, is that we rely on a couple of things that drove the business, and that has changed radically. But the trends we relied on in those days, okay, the first one was globalization. Friedman. Okay, the flat world. And then Victor and I wrote a book called Competing in the Flat World. Okay, it was basically the globalization of everything. The idea that this is a period of time where the world became a much easier place to trade. Those are my years. It's now getting very difficult. Okay, and if you want me to get into like Trump and the potential of a trade war, I can do that maybe later. Okay, but basically what happened then was that it was GATT, G-A-T-T. It was then followed by WTO. Okay, the barriers to trade were coming down in that period. Okay, tariffs were reduced to very low levels. On top of that, transportation costs were also being lowered a lot. Okay, and one of the simplest things, one of the simplest inventions that man made to facilitate trade is what? The container. The invention of a simple standardized container facilitated trade so much and made transportation so much cheaper. If you look at the big ships of today, okay, Maersk, if you look at Maersk, they have a ship now called Madrid, 20,000 TEUs, 20-foot equivalent units. That means about, your 40-foot containers is 10,000 containers in one boat. Okay, that was basically what brought the transportation down. Trade friction was decreased because of the lowering of tariffs and so on. And it was a great era for trade. It was the flat world. Okay, because of that advantage in costs coming down, okay, there's a law of globalization. The idea is that, it costs me so much for labor in America, it's a lot cheaper doing it in Hong Kong, then Taiwan, then Korea, then Southeast Asia, and so on. And everything was sort of along those lines. And I'll tell you later the difference between the old supply chain that I knew and worked in, and Victor and I think very kindly, the prophet said that we pioneered some aspects of global supply chains. Okay, compared to today, where things are very different, and that's the disruption. Okay, so the offshoring became commonplace. Okay, anything that you can offshore that other countries have had advantage of. It was the great age of comparative advantage. For those of you who remember Economics 101, that was the big comparative advantage theory. If other people have the cheaper labor, they should be able to do, they should do that part of the business. Okay, and the second thing is outsourcing. I was inspired by a book called In Search of Excellence. It's a very old book in the 1980s, where it talked about people should stick to their knitting. That was the term that was used. People should focus. They focus on what they do best. And even if you could do something maybe better than somebody else, it doesn't mean you waste the time with it. The favorite example I have is that when I was going to school, you know, at university, I was actually a very fast typer because my mom had the foresight to send me to typing school before I left for America. And I used to earn a living, 25 cents US a page. Okay, so I was a fast typer. So when I came back, I was faster than my secretary, frankly. Okay, but that doesn't mean that I should do the typing, right? If somebody else can do it, okay, even though they may be slower than you, okay, it still is worth my while to let her do the typing rather than me. That's really the theory of comparative advantage in a nutshell, is that somebody can do something better than you, okay, it's okay, of course you outsource, but if somebody can do it cheaper than you, of course you outsource, but even you can do it better in many ways, the guns and butter, if those are the professors you remember, between on the comparative advantage theory. And so outsourcing, after that book came out and so on, it became the norm. You know, people want to focus on what they do best, and what they don't do best, they want to outsource to other people to do. And that's one of the things that sustained what we were doing, basically acting as the sourcing agent, as the sourcing person overseas or something, because we understood the local conditions. We have great friends in the production area, you know, like Kenneth, and so on. And so we basically did that for a living, and that sustained us. These are the trends that sustained us. All these are changing, by the way. Okay? Now, the management theories that govern our business, one is the supply chain management. That was a great time when people talked about supply chains. Supply chains was not really studied until really the 80s and 90s. And now everybody talks about supply chains, you know, the lean supply chains. They talk about, you know, all the global supply chains that Victor and I were so involved in and so on. And of course, the idea of managing change, which I'll come to. I think this is the crux of my talk, is really the global, the change management. Now, so what happened in that period, 79 to 2009? Again, notice 30 years. And I'll tell you a minute why 2009 was another watershed year, okay, in the world, okay? Basically, this was the era of global supply chains, which Victor and I were involved in. WTO came in, trade became even more frictionless, and things were looking very good. And China, since it rejoined the world in 1979, fulfilled its first promise. There are two promises of China. Okay, the first promise is that we can be, because of our labor and the productivity of our labor, China says that we can be the supplier to the world, at least on labor-intensive manufacturing. And during these 30 years, until 2009, they fulfilled that promise. They became the world's factory. That was the period. That was the 30 years where China became the world's factory. And all of you are probably well familiar with the rise of China. And the fact that how they capitalized on their labor force, how they moved the labor force to the coastal areas, how they set up the special economic zones, the SEZs, okay, to do all the export trade. And because of that, okay, they basically earned the foreign exchange that allowed them to then develop their local economy. And that was the period, okay, where China was the ascendancy. That was the miracle of China. I'm sure you've heard so many lectures about this. I won't go into this. But that was the period. Okay, and Hong Kong changed its nature, really to a business and financial center for China, primarily. Okay, and what happened to us is that we were third generations were running the company, Victor and I. By the way, there's two of us, you know, there's Victor Fung and William Fung. And I'll tell you the standard joke in the company. Victor's the smarter one. He's the older brother, he's a much smarter one. I went to Harvard Business School, he taught at Harvard Business School. That's the difference. And so in our company, the joke is that his name is Victor, starts with V. V is, you know, for what? For vision. He's the visionary for the company. And unfortunately, my name starts with W. And you know what W stands for, right? Work. Okay. So it's a perfect partnership. He had the vision. I basically worked to try to implement that vision. Okay, but anyway, so we, the third generations were there, and we basically globalized the company. That's what you saw earlier. You know, the 40 countries, we went all over the world. we were basically perfecting what we thought was the model for the supply chain, which is a global supply chain that reaches into every corner of the earth looking for the next more cost-effective, I won't use the word cheapest, but cost-effective market. And on top of that, okay, at that time, the supply chains, the requirements of our customers for supply chain was basically in search of lower costs. Okay, that is also going to change, and I'll come to that in a minute. Okay, so what we did was to go to the ends of the earth. Okay, if there's a 10% price difference in labor, 15% price difference in labor between Vietnam and southern China, we would have to go to Vietnam. Okay, if there's another 10% difference in price somewhere, we would have to go there. So we basically spread out our tentacles around the world. The good thing about that, other than looking for cheaper prices, it gave us a lot of flexibility. That's one thing that we've always argued about supply chains. You can get the supply chain, you can get your supply chain so efficient, you wound it so tight, okay, you have such a narrow supply chain that if something happens to any one of those suppliers or supplying countries, okay, you're left standing still. You remember when Thailand had that problem, you know, and the whole Japanese car production came to a standstill because the vital parts were coming from Thailand. Okay, sometimes you can't wind your supply chain too tight. You got to have a little bit more flex in it to allow you the flexibility, especially today, and I'll come to that, okay, where the world is moving from a multilateral, basically advanced or enlightened way of dealing in trade, where everybody says there's something called the most favored nation, I'm sure you remember, that I'll extend the same privileges to everybody I trade with, even though they might not have the same privilege to me. And we're out of that era now. Now people talk about bilateral trade. They talk about free trade agreements between countries. And of course, the biggest proponent of that would be somebody like Donald Trump. Okay, instead of saying that, let's let the world go free and multilateral. Okay, so that is really the good thing about our group in terms of a global line. We're really very flexible. If something happens to China, I can give you one statistic. If something happened to China in terms of trade with the United States, especially a punitive duty on something kind of like garments, okay, which they're not, by the way, you know, thankfully, so far they haven't focused on that. I can talk about that and what America is focused on attacking. But it's not the old traditional labor-intensive types of products like apparel and toys and footwear. Because all that will do is raise the standard of the cost of living for the Walmart customers. That's all it will do, because there's no other place in the world and nobody's going to bring that production back to America. But in any case, going back to that, okay, we were basically saying that in that kind of a world, okay, where there's people are looking for bilateral deals, our ability to go around that is very easy. So give you an idea, in the apparel area, only 30% of our production is in China. Okay, the rest is all over. Okay, it's not the same, it's much more concentrated in what we call the hard goods area in China. But so our vulnerability to any one market is actually quite low because we have a diverse portfolio. And by the way, that's one of the things we'll talk about. In an uncertain world, okay, I'll come back to that later. The only way that I know how to deal with uncertainty in the world, other than what I'm going to talk about in terms of the way we plan, okay, is basically have a diverse portfolio of either businesses or countries you manufacture. Because the only way that the traditional way of dealing with risk in an uncertain situation is to have a portfolio of things that you can go to. So you're not have all your eggs, as the proverbial says, that you don't have all your eggs in one basket. So if I go now to the future, okay, this is the part I like to spend a little bit of time on. And here, like I said, I'm more an observer than the front lines. My nephew, Spencer Fung, is at the front lines. But basically, it all started with the rest of the world, I think, with a financial tsunami. Okay, why people ask me, why, William, why suddenly, in these last few years, okay, there's so much technology disruption. Okay, and of course, change itself tends to accelerate, and change leads to other change, so it tends to be accelerating effect. But what sparked it off, and what's different between these 30 years and the previous 30 years? Okay, and I would tell you that it's really the financial tsunami in America, and frankly, the Western government's response to it, that I think was the spark that started off the tsunami, not in financial terms, but in technology. What happened was that you remember quantitative easing. Okay, the governments of the world started to pump a lot of money into the economies. Interest rates went to the floor. It almost cost you nothing to get capital. And guess what the technologies needed? They needed a lot of free capital. or capital that says that, look, I'm going to bet on 10 startups, okay, because some of them will come up with some new technology. So the real impetus at that time was because of the financial tsunami, and is continuing to a great extent. If you look at the distortions in the capital markets because of the cheap money, because of the low interest rates, okay, you see what I mean. You're now facing a world in the capital markets where a company, okay, that makes electric cars, okay, is worth more than GM in market cap. You're looking at a company called Amazon, okay, that's worth more than Walmart. Okay, that is the discrepancy that's happening in the market today. And that's all because I think it all started with a financial tsunami, which then led to technology and technological disruptions. And primarily, the disruption is in, as far as I'm concerned, there are other technology changes, you know, with product and with materials and all kinds of things. But what concerned me the most, and my business most, is actually the disruption in information technology. It's the advent of the use of the internet leading to e-commerce, which I'll talk a little bit more before I get on to the solutions. However, in this period also, in these 30 years, it just started, and I'll come back to the reason why 2009 was the watershed year. I don't know if many of you remember, but in the winter of 2009 and the spring of 2010, there was a series of mysterious suicides at Foxconn in China. Workers were jumping off the roofs of the dormitories. And Terry Guo, okay, our friend, our Taiwanese friend, don't know why. Okay, and what he did, okay, in the spring of 2010 is to increase the wages. He thought it was a wage problem. He increased the wages of his workers 50% in less than six months. Now, for many of you who work in China, you would know that a wage hike like that is not allowed. It's not allowed by something called the China Federation of Trade Unions, because it scares away foreign investors. It is not allowed unless the leadership has decided that we need to change policy. Up till this period, up till 2009, okay, China was basically pursuing a policy of low wage rates as much as possible, stable industrial relations, bring in the FDI, foreign direct investment. But in 2009, what Victor and I saw was a very clear change in policy in China. And what we signaled and subsequently proved to be correct in the 12-5-year plan, and I'll come back to the Chinese planning system because it's relevant for what I'm going to say later. The 12-5-year plan, China announced its switch to the second engine for growth. The first engine of growth was exports, using labor intensive, using its labor. The second engine for growth was its domestic economy. They're revving up now the domestic economy, domestic consumption. So one of the consequences of that, and I think you see it over this 30 years, again, 30 years, okay, is that by, for sure, maybe even earlier, by the end of this period, China will be the world's largest consumer market. Okay, now this has always been around. This was around even in the period before. When I first went into China in 1978, they were already talking about something called the billion toothbrush syndrome. Let me tell you what that is. They said that China is so big, 1.3 billion people. If P&G only sold one toothbrush to every Chinese, they'd get very rich, okay, the size of the market. That frankly never happened. In fact, that's what the US is griping about. They want China to open up faster. They never opened up the import market. Tariffs were still high. They made some commitments when they entered the WTO. Okay, but by and large, okay, I think most people would say that China has been very good in terms of opening up its markets. They are now. And part of the tools that Xi Jinping is using to diffuse this problem with the Americans is to say, I'm going to open up even faster and wider. But during that period, the first period, 79 to 2009, it never happened. But now it's happening. And they will become the world's largest consumer market. Okay, and I think this is the part that everybody's saying that if I were doing any business, and I think that applies to any of you here, okay, in the period 79 to 2009, I would say the way you make money from China is to use China's labor advantage and export. The way you make money in the next 30 years is to see how you can exploit the local Chinese market for consumption. Okay, so that's something that I think is very clear. And that's why I say is the beginning of a new era. And coupled with the technological disruptions, okay, I think that you have a very interesting period of time. You know, as all my Western friends always say, they always ask, is it true William, that the Chinese word for crisis, like, okay, is opportunity and danger. I said, yes, that's the way the Chinese describes, you know, crisis. And we're in a crisis here, but there's opportunity and there are dangers. Well, I think Hong Kong really has now broadened its scope to really think about the world. And my friend Vincent Low is at the forefront of making sure that Hong Kong is going to be relevant, not just for China, but for the rest of the world. By the way, that's why I said Ban Wen Longfu, he's the chairman of the Hong Kong TDC. So then what do we do? Okay, we are doing now what the provost, I think, or the dean said. Spencer now is creating the supply chain of the future. And let me go into what that is. Okay, one of the things that is very clear to us in this period, in the last few years, has really been the disruption in the whole supply chain by the advent of e-commerce. E-commerce is the delivery of goods, right? Basically interacting through the internet with consumers, okay, the delivery of goods directly to the consumer. And that's disrupting what they call the brick and mortar world tremendously. And frankly, those are all our customers. Our customers have traditionally been, okay, the brick and mortar people, and their business is now being disrupted. And being disrupted in a very major way. Our view of what has happened is that if you look at what's happening in the market, okay, most of that disruption is occurring at the consumer interface. That means the interface between the stores and the consumer. Everything you hear about is that how Amazon is taking business away from all the brick and mortar guys. They tell you about all the amazing things that's happening in terms of the technology that connects the consumer. This is all part of the doctor thing I talked about. Consumers are now more educated than ever. A lot of people do research on the internet before they go in and buy. And there's all different ways of using the internet. In England, they call it click and collect. They order on the internet, they go and collect it in the store. So it's a combination, and that might be the future. But all of the action is highly crazy. It's basically in the consumer space. And this consumer space, because of people like Alibaba, because of people like Amazon, and because of the market share they're taking, and because of the market capitalization and the values that the stock market has given them, they now have the money to do a lot of data. You probably read about Facebook. So it's not limited to just e-commerce. It's also the way you talk to your consumers, the way you find out what they like to buy, what their tastes are. Okay, all that is happening. It's a frenzy. It's a frenzy of activity over there. Okay, guess what? Most people have neglected the supply chain. Okay, this is now highly digital. And the way we see this world is that your production and your supply side, okay, is basically analog. It has not changed much. It's now changing. But it's basically, so you basically have a situation of analog supply chains, okay, meeting a highly digitized world of consumer demand, and the thing doesn't work. Except for a large use of inventory. Lots and lots of inventory. Okay, Alibaba, Jack Ma, was very fond of telling people, you know, when I met him right after November 11th, he said, you know, William, you know how much we did? $18 billion in one day. And he was very proud of that. I was tempted, but I didn't. I asked him, do you know how much inventory is left? Okay, maybe you did $18 billion, but what if there's another $18 billion of inventory left over? What if, okay, 4 weeks before Singles Day, there was actually almost no sales? What if after Singles Days, there was almost no sales, because everything squeezed into one day? It's not as if, you know, this is like extra consumption. It might be, some of it might be, but a lot of it is not. So the way you solve this inventory, how do you think the consumer gets 24-hour delivery if the delivery is not already sitting there? So somebody made a decision. If it's a tie, somebody made the decision that this orange with little red dots will be good, and it's sitting there waiting for Singles Day. Okay, everything on the internet, this interface, you're talking about 24 hours. In the city, 7 hours. Okay, everything is based on instantaneous gratification. Okay, and this is really the state of the world we see today. And guess what? What's been largely ignored is the supply side. Very few people are working on it. Okay, we hope to be one of them. We hope to be at the forefront of that. Okay, but very few people are working on how do you make the supply chain, which is now largely analog, work with a highly digitized consumer space. And what we're trying to say here is that what you need to do, everything that I learned in supply chain theory, which I said is one of the business theories underlying our business model before, was basically inventory was a big deal. Inventory was bad. Okay, smaller the inventory, the better the business. Because inventory, okay, the thing that we got to understand is that you might go to the ends of the earth for 5 or 10% labor difference. But if you make the wrong merchandise that consumers do not want, guess what the markdown is? All the girls here will know, 30%, 40%, 50%. That's your biggest cost, is the markdown cost. Okay, and inventory, in a lot of us, in our eyes, equals markdown. Right, Kenneth? So at least at the consumer level. So that how do you minimize inventory? What you need then is an interface, okay, a digitalized interface that works with the digitalized marketplace. Okay, and be able to respond just as quickly. Okay, and that's what we're working on. Okay, we're not definitely at this moment in our three-year plan. I'll talk about our planning system later. We cannot say that we're even close to winning the war, but I think we've gotten some good traction. Okay, this is my nephew's work, not mine. I'm an observer. So what we hope Li and Fung will do is basically to have a digitized platforms that could deal with both the customers and the suppliers. Okay, and that get the information, get the orders, et cetera, from the digital side, translate it, and if necessary, go the traditional analog way. But we're also trying to get our more advanced manufacturers to work with us digitally and basically link up the whole system in a digital way. Now, how does that help? Perhaps I could tell you a story. You know, I saw Jeff Bezos about a year and a half ago, and I knew him because he was a Princeton guy and I was a Princeton guy. And anyway, He said something very funny to me. He says that, you know, William, we're very lucky. This is the first time I met him 3 years ago. Now, he said, we're very lucky. As long as I keep growing my top line by 20% or more, I will keep my market capitalization. And therefore, I'm not too worried about the supply chain. Okay, however, the day when people require me to make a profit, I better look at how the supply chain will help me on inventory and other things. Okay, that's from a 100% online digital retailer. Okay, the same thing is happening now. Okay, the war that's happening now is at the interface in terms of for survival. It's a war for survival. It's over here with the brick and mortar people. They're all morphing. And what are they morphing towards? They're actually morphing to a hybrid. And I'm in the camp that basically says that the stable retail format of the future is a hybrid of online and offline. Okay, what the Americans call omni-channel. Okay, what the Chinese call O2O, online to offline, offline to online. Okay, O2O, that's going to be the steady state. Witness, okay, some evidence of that, and it's not going to be the pure play eating up all the brick and mortar. In fact, if you look at the world today, less than 10% of the world's total retail is done over the internet. But that's the whole world. It's much higher in China. China could be 20% more, maybe 30 close to. Okay, in America, it's probably like 10 to 15% is the numbers we hear a lot about. Okay, but the stable state, you know, will be somewhere there. Okay, one will never completely overtake the other. Okay, but in the meantime, there's a lot of pain. You know, and the pain is, what is the pain? The pain is that probably in the West, in the Western markets, which are the big markets today, although China's interesting markets growing very quickly. In the West today, that means America and Europe, we probably overstored, too many stores. It's not good English, but we have too many stores. So people are now decreasing the number of stores. Our research institute estimates that this year, 2018, there'll be about 10,000 stores that's going to be just taken out of the system because there's too many stores, because you don't need so many if you have the internet. They're taking a big part of your business. Okay, and the second thing is that with a new supply chain that Spencer Fung is creating, we're actually shortening the cycles. The shortening the cycles have two benefits. One is responding to customers' need more timely. But the other thing that is happening is that you're reducing the inventory, as I said here. So you're destocking. Okay, that's the word that's being used. They're destocking. And destocking means that they actually buy less. They need to buy less. They need less inventory, okay, to keep the pipelines full because they're now smaller orders, bigger, faster turns. Okay, so all of this is actually not good for our business. I don't know if Kenneth agrees. Again, this is Ban with Long Fu. You know, Kenneth is the expert here on that. Okay, but this is basically what we see happening. So what does that mean? That merely means that, okay, as we do this, supply this way, this is at least an interim solution. We don't know where this will end because we don't know what proportion in the future will stabilize at. It will stabilize at some sort of proportion. Okay, I was asked. I did a conference where I talked about this internet and how it affects retailers, and the title of my talk was actually "The Death of E-commerce." And I don't mean that e-commerce will go away. I mean that e-commerce just becomes commerce. It's the same. Commerce is how you satisfy your customers, your consumers, either with a physical store or with something, you know, on the food delivery to home. Okay, but it's nothing strange about it anymore. When Victor and I took a trip to Silicon Valley last year, we talked to about 20 or so startups. They were all in this area, and you know, they hardly talked about e-commerce. They talked mainly about using the internet through things like social media, find out what the consumers want, see what their preferences are and tastes, you know, what colors they like, what styles they like, and so on. So really, the internet's becoming more a tool of a communication with a consumer rather than e-commerce delivering to the home. So we just said e-commerce. So I was asked the question by somebody in the audience. I said, well, what is prone for e-commerce and what is prone for brick and mortar stores? And I don't know, but I took a stab at the answer. I said, well, maybe if on discretionary goods, in other words, when you have a discretion as what to buy, you may want to shop. If you're buying a nice dress, okay, like what Alien's wearing, okay, you probably want to go to the store and see what is there, try it on, etc. If it's non-discretionary spending, okay, like toilet paper, okay, like rice, like water, why not order it? You know, there's no good experience shopping. That's another big thing. I could go on, of course, for a long time on this. Okay, what's happening with brick and mortar is moving towards what they call experiential experiences. Okay, that's why you're going to see in the future with department stores, other stores, more pop-up stores. They want newness. They want it to be an experience for consumers to actually physically go, give them a reason for going. Otherwise, why wouldn't they sit in the comfort of their home and just order what they want? So anyway, discretionary and non-discretionary spending is what I think will happen. Okay, so let me tell you why it's important. The first step when we do the supply chain of the future is the following. How you digitize, you're going to first digitize the supply chain. Reason why? We have a lot of analog data now. I mean, we work with, as the provost said, 15,000 factories. Okay, we have a lot of customers. We have 1,000 something, almost 2,000 customers. We have a lot of data. It's an analog form, which means it's not very useful. So the first thing you've got to do in personal process is digitize that data. Because only after you have digitized data would the data become useful. That's the whole thing. You're turning not so useful or a lot of just hard to analyze data into something that is analyzable. So the next thing is that once you have the digital data, guess what? You can now apply data analytics. I'm using all the buzzwords of the new economy. You can now do smart analytics, okay, on the data. Okay, you can now manipulate the data. Okay, now you can do what you want with the data. And because you can do that, you can do the data analytics, guess what? You get insights, right? You get insights into how the consumer spent, okay? And then the basis for doing things like artificial intelligence, AI. So I'm sorry to use all these buzzwords, but they're on everybody's lips now. You know, things like blockchain technology. Before you do any of those crazy things, you need the data to be digitized. So you must first digitize all the data, and that's a big job, okay? And then after you do that, okay, you can even talk, see, up to this point, the way I look at this, up to this point, it allows you to do your existing business more efficiently. It allows you to get insight from the data, allows you to do everything. But what's the next thing? You change the business model. Okay, that's the big change. That is the big change. In fact, this is the final disruption of technology, is that not only are they an enabler. See, most people say, oh, okay, technology, it enables you to do your existing job better and faster and without mistakes. But the real guts of this is that ultimately allows you to change the business model. I'll give you one example, Tesla. Okay, I mentioned electric cars earlier. Tesla, the first car, revolutionary technology, right? Electric motor. Okay, they don't need this combustion engine block. But guess what the car looks like? It looks like a regular car, except in the front, you lift up the hood, it's empty. You lift up the back, it's a big hood. Because people can't accept, you can't change too radically. But once you've decided that the whole drivetrain, okay, can be flat and on the bottom of your car, guess what you can do? You can change the car completely. It won't look like a car anymore. You can sit right at the front, okay, because there's no engine block in front of you. You can make it smaller because you don't need so much trunk space. You can change the whole. So that's what I mean. Most people look at technology as an enabler for doing things faster and better than the old way. But the real change of technology is allows you to do things differently, and that's the disruption. And most people don't get to that point. So when we say that our goal is to create the supply chain of the future, okay, this is from Spencer Fung. That's his mandate in the 3-year plan. Okay, he thinks that nobody's spending enough time, and it's probably true, on the supply side. So far, all the work's been done on the consumer side. Okay, so when he talks about supply chain change, okay, he's talking about creating a new kind of supply chain that is highly digitized, that works with a highly digitized consumer interface. Okay, and that is something new, and we hope to be, one of the first to get do something meaningful with that because of our database, because of our reach, and so on. But of course, he's a sort of millennial. He's 40, but he's an old millennial. Okay, but he also wants to do something in the CSR area, right? Corporate social responsibility compliance. So he says that, well, I want a higher purpose. I don't want to just make more money. Okay, so he wants to affect the lives of 1 billion people in the supply chain. And I said, hey, how do you get 1 billion people? He said, well, if you take all the factories we use, if you take all the workers in the factories, if you take all the family of the workers, if you take all the consumers where we give them, good, well-priced goods to lower their or improve their standard of living, and you look at their families, maybe by the time we get done, there'll be 1 billion people affected by what we do. So that's his sort of higher goal. And I think the purpose, that's another thing I think, Dean, you probably teach your students now, is that, companies should have a purpose, instead of just making money. That's the sort of the old, sort of the William Victor Fung days. Okay, but the new generation is more than just making money. Okay, now all of that is really a retrospective. How about something useful? You say, hey, William, that's fine, it's a brief history of the world and economics and what's happening. But how about something useful? Well, here I hope to share with you something that I hope is useful. How does Li and Fung deal with this? And we've been, actually, we had this system, and again, with Victor Fung, he did the theory. I tried to implement it, and we've done this for a lot of years. It's the way, this is what is happening. How do you manage rapid change? And being the professor he is, Victor Fung counts the way the competency, a company's competency in managing change, how well he manages change, like going to school. He's saying that, look, if change is all around you and you don't react to it, you don't respond in the right way, your history won't even rate you. You're gone. You won't survive very long. Okay, your history. Now, if the change is happening all around you and you react to it, okay, you react to change, okay, you survive, but you're like primary school level in terms of competence. So he says, if you can react to change, you're okay. That's you, Hawking, though. Okay? Now, if you have somebody in the company who's can see, look down the pike, sorry, that's an American term, can see what's coming down in the future, okay, and say that I'm going to anticipate change. I can see what's happening, coming down, and I want to anticipate the change, then you're pretty good. But as far as Victor Fung is concerned, you're only secondary school. Okay, you can anticipate change. Okay, most people would say that, well, isn't that pretty good? I mean, you already have a foresight to know what's coming and you do something in advance. Okay, not good enough, according to Victor Fung. He said that you must be brave enough and have enough foresight that if something coming down the pike, okay, is so big that you allow yourself to be reinvented. If you don't stop yourself from reinvention, a good example is Kodak. They knew what was coming down the road. They had all the technology for the new cameras. They stuck with film. Okay, they died. Okay, a successful example, IBM. Okay, they did the hardware. They did all hardware. They did the CPUs, the big CPUs. They changed and became a consulting company, all software. Okay, so you must not, if you're not afraid to reinvent yourself, then you will survive. Okay, now this is the dividing line. If you're not afraid to reinvent, this is the dividing line between a reactive response to change and a proactive response to change. In other words, this is the part where you say that, hey, I can do things differently. I can do a bit different business model. Okay, if you don't reinvent yourself, you're probably just saying that, oh, I'm just gonna cope. You cope much better here than you're doing here, right? But you're still just reacting to anticipate a change. Okay, but if you can really say that, look, what's coming down the pike is so serious that I need to redo my business model, okay, then you're really at the point of the university. But Dr. Victor Fung wants us to do better than that. He wants to say, how do you institutionalize the process of reinvention? How do you make it part of your whole business, the way you do business, that you basically institutionalize this process? You can't just rely on one or two clever guys, you know, your CEO. So once in a while, he'll jump up and say, hey, we've got to do this. Okay, how do you make it a constant part of your business thing? And he says, the challenge is, how do you institutionalize the reinvention? And what he came up with, which I had to implement, okay, is basically, why don't we put that into our planning process? And he and I, you know, are both products of American business schools, and what is taught in the business schools about planning does not incorporate anything like this at all. And what it does is not amenable to it. My apologies to all the professors here who might be actually teaching sort of what I'm going to come to next. Okay, so we have a three-year plan. Maybe it's not 3 years, maybe it's 5 years, maybe it's 10 years if you're in the real estate business, for instance, or where the gestation period is longer. Okay, but for us, 3 years is long enough. We incorporate this process of reinvention into our three-year plan. How do we do that? Okay, most plans, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, is based on something the American business school calls the rolling plan. That means I have a three-year plan. Every year I update it. That's good, right? Because I take into account changes, I update it. We tried that for 25 years. And basically what has happened is just becomes an exercise by the management. Oh yeah, it's time to do the three-year plans, and then they change the numbers a little bit here and there. That does not facilitate reinvention. Okay, what we love, okay, is what we learned from the Chinese Communist planning system. The Chinese Communist Party plans on a fixed plan. In other words, they have a five-year plan, as you all know, okay, and it's fixed. They don't change it every year. They don't change the goalposts every year. Okay, and what happens, okay, with this is that we love the fixed plan. In fact, we think this might be the Chinese Communist Party's biggest contribution to business studies. Okay, it's a fixed plan and not the rolling plan. Okay, and so we do a fixed plan because we don't want to move the goalposts. We like what they do. We say from this year, 5 years from now, we're going to be there. That's our plan. They don't change it. The good things about it, from a manager's point of view, is that the goals are clear. It's not changing all the time. If you keep shifting the goalposts, your management will just say that, oh, don't worry about it. Don't worry about the plan. It'll be changed again next year. It'll be changed again next year. So the goalpost is set. Plus, sometimes, you know, to get to a goal, the path may not be like this. It may be like this, right? It may be like this. Okay, so the idea is that, look, why don't we have fixed goalposts for the end of the plan? Okay, and I'll come to that, what that means by the end of the plan. But so our characteristic of the way we try to do reinvention in our three-year plan is, the first, it must be a fixed plan. The second thing is that we must be zero-based. Okay, otherwise, how can you get reinvention if you're not zero-basing yourself? So what you ask yourself every 3 years is that, this is the question, it's the tough question. Okay, the question we ask ourselves is that, if we are not in this business today, would we invest in this business? Will we go into this business? Now, that's a real test. I have staff who come to me, they say, you know, Mr. Fung, I like to do that with my own career. You know, I like to say that, look, everybody has, it's basically inertia, right? This is inertia. Institutions, companies, people has inertia. They're in it, okay, let's keep going. You know, but if you stop every 3 years, in our case, and ask yourself, if I am not in the business today, will I want to go into this business? This is for personal. If I'm not a banker today, would I now apply for a job in a bank? If the answer is no, you better make some changes. Now, that is reinvention. So that's another important criteria for reinvention. Okay? So just in case people say that, well, how can sometimes things change very dramatically? How can you not change the targets if things, a big change comes along? Well, I'll tell you why not. Okay, we actually don't change our targets. Let's say we think that there's no trade war, we didn't even know Donald Trump was contemplating anything, and we basically decided on a certain target for 3 years. What if suddenly Donald Trump now declares a 25% tariff on all my products? And all my people flop their arms and say, how can you expect me to keep to the plan? Okay, my costs are now up 25%. Well, part of the beauty of what we designed, okay, Victor and I, is that we do ask them to keep it. You know why? Because once you do that, okay, you force somebody to think out of the box. Okay, if I'm still keeping the same targets despite these very adverse circumstances, I will have to do something different. Most people react to adversity by working harder. They say, oh yeah, I'm so tired. Instead of going home at 7, I'll go home at 8, 9. You know, 老婆罵我都是這樣. Okay? But what they should actually ask themselves is that they're so tough now, why don't I do things differently? Instead of trying to do the same thing. This is what most people react to. I mean, this is 45 years of observing people's behavior. They just work harder doing the same thing. Okay, so keeping these targets fixed means that you really have to change the way you work. And that, again, facilitates reinvention. Now, so what is the first step? Now, this is, again, unlike the way that Americans sort of teach planning. The Americans teach planning like this, right? Okay, William Fung, you have to do the next three-year plan. And in the old way, you know, somebody like me would say, okay, I start off with, let's say, $10 million sales. Next year, I'll do 11. Okay, 老闆不可以 say, okay, I'll do 12. I'll work really hard. And then after that, I'll do this, and then I'll do this. They're starting from the existing base. What we do differently is that at the beginning, when we do a three-year plan, we first go to the end of the three-year plan. So let's say we're sitting today here, we take a jump, whoops, sorry, to the end of the plan. And the first thing we do is we paint a scenario. We ask ourselves, what is the business like in 3 years from now? What's happening with the China-US relations? Where is Vietnam in terms of their costs? Is Myanmar the new country where people are going to now? What's happening with Ethiopia? Okay, what's happening with fashion? So we jump to the end of the plan and we paint a scenario of what we think the world is around us for that plan. Okay, then, and it's not too difficult, you're in the business to say what will happen. In 3 years, what will happen? You know, what will happen to internet in 3 years? What percentage of our customers' business will be internet and therefore require larger, faster response times, smaller quantities, and so on? So you paint a scenario of what's happening around you, okay, and then you paint yourself into it. You say that this is what I like to do, okay, because my view in 3 years is that Vietnam will be very competitive. I want 12% of my production to be in Vietnam. You paint yourself in that scenario. Okay, so you're 3 years now from where you are today, you're in the future, and you paint yourself in that future scenario. Okay, and then you're gonna set stretch goals. I think it's probably too long to talk about it, I'll come to that later. And then you do, this is American business, you do what they call backward planning. See, you're now 3 years down the road, you turn around and you say, hey, there's a gap between where I am today and where I want to be 3 years from now. This is where I want to be 3 years from now. Okay, this is where I am today, there's a gap. So let's think about what strategies. Okay, think about the business strategies will get us across that gap. What do I need to do in these 3 years to get me to where I want to be in 3 years' time? Okay, and then once I decided what the strategy is, okay, then I got to understand, well, let's talk about organization, skills I need, capital I need, et cetera, et cetera. This is standard backward planning. So it's no, this is not big. The big thing was actually the fixed plan is zero-based. Okay, so it is different. And I tell you what this does for us is that every 3 years, we basically look at our business very fundamentally and decide what we want to do and what we want to be in 3 years' time. And in Spencer Fung terms, okay, in this current three-year plan, he's just gone through the first year of his three-year plan, he wants to have the supply chain of the future pretty much done at the end of the 3 years. And he's painted a picture of what does that supply chain should look like. It should cater to both the traditional brick and mortar customers as well as the internet customer and the hybrids, which we think is the final state. Okay, so that's where he thinks the world's going to be. He thinks that, okay, this is, for example, I'll give you an example. He says that, you know, in your time, the supply chain, the global supply chain that you and dad sort of created, you know, was based on optimizing costs. You want to minimize the costs of doing the supply. That's why you go to cheaper countries. But guess what? The supply chain of the future is going to optimize on speed. Okay, it's going to be a much faster supply chain because guess what? Speed not only accomplishes cost because what I said earlier, right? Because if you have speed, if you allow people a shorter lead time, they can see clearly what's going to sell. They get information from the internet, they'll get information from our supply chain, and they say, okay, the girls are going to buy yellow and the skirts are going to be above the knee. You can either make that decision a year or 6 months before you're actually selling it, or you can make it 3 weeks before you actually sell it. Okay, so 3 weeks, obviously, you're going to be more accurate. Okay, so speed, first of all, takes care of a lot of the cost of markdown. Okay, but more importantly, okay, speed basically deals with a very fundamental thing of change. Okay, because the new customers are fickle. Okay, they are changing, their tastes are changing all the time. So you really need this faster response time in order to deal with what's coming down the pike in the smaller orders. I'm actually overrunning quite a bit. And really, that's what I like to say about a practical way of dealing with change. Okay, I'm sure there are many other ways, but the way that the only thing I would say is that you need a systematic way. That's what Victor Fung means by institutionalizing the process of reinvention. It's not just somebody waking up one morning, say, or reading something in the newspaper and say, boy, I better do something. Okay, that's ad hoc. That's an ad hoc reaction. Don't forget what I said earlier. If you're on that side of the chart, of Victor Fung's chart, you're just reacting to change. If you want to be proactive and you want to be able to reinvent yourself, you better go on this side of the chart and become a Baptist youth graduate, a university graduate, okay? If not a graduate school graduate. Okay, so thank you very much. I hope you found it interesting. Questions now?
Right, we have some time for Q&A. Oh. Every time I see someone else do this job, that person always takes the opportunity to ask the first question. So I'm going to take that opportunity. Why not? Because I really do have a question. I'm interested in this supply chain of the future, and I'm interested in its impact on the location of manufacturing. Because what I'm hearing in the UK and what I'm hearing in parts of the US is that certain elements of manufacturing seem to be being reborn there. It might be the high-end stuff, but you're saying that speed is of the essence, and we know that if you're stuck with a long supply chain with big inventories, you're having to sell at a discount. It's that geography issue.
Yes, okay, let me answer it in two ways. I think the first one is that, yeah, there'll be a lot of, there will be more local manufacturing, but more importantly, I think there'll be more local manufacturing of the future industries that haven't left your domestic market yet. Okay, in fact, that's exactly what the US is trying to do now. If you think about it, okay, Donald Trump is targeting a program that China has talked about called Made in China 2025. Okay, the 10 industries that China's talking about are the industries of the future. You're talking about electric vehicles, self-driving vehicles, you're talking about all kinds of all the new industries. So what they're doing, which is very smart of them, because they're not stupid, other than the president. His advisor is not stupid. They said, look, what we should do is to make sure that we don't lose these industries of the future to China. Because if they don't put in constraints now on China, they may lose those industries, because China is also targeting everyone. All the advanced economies, Japan, Korea, everybody's targeting those industries. And if America is going to keep that competitive advantage, what they think, which I think is wrong, because I'm a really multilateralist, they say that we're going to keep our rich domestic market to ourselves for a while and not let the Chinese in. You know, so I think that kind of manufacturing will thrive in America. As I said earlier, there's no way they're going to bring back labor-intensive manufacturing, like garment making or making shoes or making. So now, what will help in terms of the speed is that what we're finding on a very practical level is that China, which we thought was losing its comparative advantage in the old model on cost terms, is actually having a new lease on life, because China can respond much quicker. Their factories are larger, their systems are better, their supply chain is more healthy. They can respond very quickly to shifts in demand. Whereas if you manufacture somewhere in Bangladesh or Myanmar, you're much slower. So in that sense, the bleeding, the decanting, we actually use the word decanting of production from China, has been slowed down by this idea that you want to be faster in the supply chain. We found that surprising for us is that our China prices are now still okay for a lot of our customers, as long as you give them the speed. They're willing to trade off, you know, price for speed. Okay, if they want the cheapest thing, like I said, you know, if they want Chinese piece goods made in Kenya, okay, they're going to wait 9 months. Okay, so I think it affects us in a funny kind of way, but not in the domestic consumption markets. I don't see that happening in Europe. I don't see that happening in America. Although a good example of proximity being important, even in our business, would be a company called Zara. Many of the girls would know Zara. Okay, 40% of their production is still in Spain and Portugal, despite the higher prices, because they need the speed. They need to really replenish very quickly. And contrary to the conventional wisdom about buying cheap and being able to make a bigger margin, they actually have the best margins in the business, and they're not cheap. They're not in terms of their buying costs. okay, but they turn faster and they have less obsolescence, and therefore they can work on the smaller markup and still be able to do it. Yeah.
Interesting. Okay, we've got a gentleman in the column on the right.
Hello, William. Always a pleasure to learn from you. This is Eric Chow. I got two questions to learn from you. One is probably more commercial driven. As the e-commerce develops and all this new technology and also new way of working together, like co-working space, do you have a negative outlook on commercial properties like retail and offices? And my second question is more about your family level. As the leader of a rich family, with a past history of losing almost everything in the case of regime change, how do you protect the wealth of the family for your next generations to go?
Okay, the first question, we can ask Vincent Lowe, but my feeling is that something like a co-working space is exemplified by companies like WeWork. We have a deal with WeWork. We supply them the furniture. Okay, with people like that, that's a new business model that was made possible because of technology. Okay, and things like Uber, the ride hailing app and so on, all that was made possible because of a new application of the technology of communications with consumers via the internet. Okay, and I think that sort of thing is definitely, I think what I said earlier, people found new business models because of the technologies, not to make existing systems work better. Okay, what they found, for example, the Uber story, I think everybody knows, right? What these people did was that, hey, we can now communicate with everybody very easily. So somebody would ask them, well, how are you different? How are you different from, let's say, taxis who go on some kind of network? He says, well, the difference is that in Uber, these are part-time guys. And what they found was that if you think about it, your car stays in the garage 90% of the day. Okay, so there are basically, this is now utilizing unutilized capacity. And then you have people, maybe it's your driver because you're not in Hong Kong, becomes an Uber driver. Okay, so he can do that and he can do it cheaper and faster than everybody else than a professional taxi driver. So he's actually reinvented the business model because of the technology. Okay, your second question about wealth. Look, frankly, I'm more interested in business models and making businesses work. As you know, our share price have collapsed. Okay, because we're part of the old economy. As you can see, I'm not wearing my jeans and my shirt. We're not too concerned about it, frankly, because I think as far as we're concerned, I think we have more than enough that for our lives. We're not so concerned about wealth preservation. Both Victor and I are still very driven by how do we make changes to the business model. And that's what Spencer really has a problem with. Two of the older generation doing backseat driving. He's trying to drive the new car of the future.
I have a written question here, which is rather a nice one. I've got another one as well. Okay, I'll look at this one. I'll just read it out. It's an interesting one. If manufacturers digitize their data and connect with consumers directly in the way that you're saying, here's the big one. What role is left for Li and Feng in that?
Yeah, but I'm very easy about this. I don't know if any of you have always heard now on the radio. For the past year, there's a very popular ad. These are by financial companies, okay? And they say that the problem is the guys making those ads are 中介 as well. Everybody's a middleman. I think it depends how much value you add. If you add no value, you're obsolete. Okay, if you add value, okay, you have a reason for existence. And if the world was perfect, okay, whoever's in the middleman basically gets what they have. Okay, I mean, look, it's very simple. I mean, I think the idea of saying that all intermediaries will be eliminated is actually crazy. I mean, a bank's an intermediary. Okay, all our customers, Kenneth and I's customers, all intermediaries. They're all retail stores, or even Amazon is an intermediary. I think it's value versus cost. Okay, you must have that value equation. As the Hui Guanmen song said, 半斤八两, you gotta pay so much, and you only if you get back enough, return will you exist. Usually, 半斤八两, however that song goes, you gotta have more. Sorry, that was a Cantonese thing.
I got some of it. I don't see hands, but I do see a written question here, and this is rather a nice one. It's on behalf of our students. I'll read it out. Dr. Fung, thank you very much for such a wonderful lecture. I don't know who said that.
Thank you.
But I agree with that. I'm sure we all do. I'm sure many students would like to join Lee and Fung. Would you please give them some tips on how to equip themselves? Many thanks.
Well, you know, the interesting thing is that I think all young people today must equip themselves to be familiar with the new technologies, for sure. And the new technologies, just not being able to do Facebook, you know. they must understand that there is, again, you know, look, one thing about technology, which is kind of a little bit crazy, okay, the new technologies, it is an enabler to a great extent to allow you to do a traditional job. Our traditional job is servicing customers in terms of their production requirements of the supply chain end, okay? It is not something that is a industry in itself. People talk about high tech as if it's an industry itself. Okay, I'll give you an analogy. Okay, when Victor and I, when the fax machine came in, okay, it made our communication so much easier with our customers. But we don't set up a fax division or a fax company to do faxes. I mean, it helps us do our job and more efficiently, and hopefully if we were smarter, we would say, how does that change the way we work? Okay, I tell you something that will change the way we work, for example, would be something like blockchain technology. It may change the role that we do in intermediation. It's no longer being a gatekeeper, and we'll be doing other things. Okay, but so we'll see how that job changes. And it's not easy. I mean, we're looking at things like AI, we're looking at things like blockchain technology, and we're saying that how would that change the nature of our job and therefore the value equation for an intermediary? Okay, and I'll tell you another thing. I should share this with the group because it's very interesting. and I don't think Jack would mind me telling you. Okay, so Jack Ma came to us, Victor and I, and says that, we're doing a logistics company or conglomeration called Cai Niao, Choi Liu. Okay, that is the logistics, Paul, you would know. Okay, and he said that we would like LF Logistics, we have a logistics company, we would like LF Logistics to be part of it. So Victor and I were very excited. And we got our president to go talk to them. This guy, his name is Joseph Fee. So Joseph comes back after 2 weeks of shaking his head and says, William, can't do a deal with them. And I said, why not? This is Alibaba, He says, what they say that we can charge for delivery of a parcel is half our delivery costs. Okay, and we flex the model this way and that. We say, what if we double, triple, quadruple sales? Still doesn't work. So we say, we must be doing something wrong. So we went back to them thinking that they'll tell us what we did wrong in our calculations. But he says, William, instead, we got a lecture. And the lecture goes like this. Ah, Lee and Fung, you're such an old world company. Don't you understand how the new economy works? Of course you lose half for every delivery you make. But don't you understand that once you announce that you're part of the Cai Niao consortium, your share price will go up 30%. That's where you make your money, stupid. Okay, now, my first reaction was, look, that's crazy. But then you think about it, what he's really saying, and this is the sort of William Fung interpretation, what he's really saying is that sometimes you just don't look at making a margin of money off your existing, obvious, apparent customers. You make it off something else. Could it be sale of data? Okay, a la Facebook. Okay, could it be something else? So your free service, right? But boy, I make a lot of money here. So it makes you think that maybe, okay, it's not so stupid after all. And in fact, I think it's Joseph Fee, not the other guy. He says that my lesson, okay, with a new economy is never make money from your customer. That's how you get market share so quickly. Okay, if you think about it, all the market cap, okay, that all these new economy companies have is because they take so much market share so quickly. And how do they do it? By losing a lot of money in the beginning. Okay, consumers recognize a good deal. My sister-in-law, Julia Fung, Victor's wife, said that she had something delivered from Shanghai to Shenzhen for 75 RMB cents. Okay, that's impossible, but that's what they charge. And guess what? Is a very loyal customer now, as long as the price is 75 cents in the future. Okay, so it's actually quite interesting to see. I'm learning. I'm a student now of the new economy. I'm trying to see what does that mean. What does it mean to be a new economy? And maybe those are some of the sort of crazier lessons.
Benson, part of the Export Association. So actually, for Lianfeng, you are very powerful. You have all the capability to build a digitalized platform. And with the new economy, how do you advise the many SME Hong Kong exporters? You know, there are more than 100,000 companies. And every company is trying to struggle and find their best position to do. I think many of them, and like the Hong Kong Export Association, promoting that they should transform, you know, from the traditional OEM business to more ODM and OBM, but that takes time and a lot of effort for a small company. Yeah. So what would be your advice for these, companies, they are willing to progress, how do they ride on the new economy and your experience? Thank you.
Well, okay, that's another Vincent Low question, you know. That's TDC's job, actually. But I could tell you that you need a certain amount of technology capability in order to even survive, because your customers, even the smaller ones, okay, will be giving you orders like electronically and so on. So at least for the intermediaries like us here, even if our stock in trade, if I'm an SME, is because I can either make the product better or go to a remote place for manufacture, I could at least be able to interface with my customer. It's almost a ticket for entry, you know, to the game. So at least you have got to have, you look at my platform, at least you have on one side, you must have that capability. It's better if you can get other people. We actually have a portal for suppliers and we have a portal for customers so that we're going to basically bring in the data. You know, so, and I think an SME might be a bit ambitious to say that we'll use data and we do data analytics and so on. But I think at least they got to be able to be au fait with the tools of the new technology. Okay, then the second thing, of course, they can do is that there are, in fact, one of the things that might be in favor of SMEs is that actually the market's getting more fragmented. Okay, I mean, we used to get big orders. We used to work for people like The Gap, and we still work for people like Walmart. Okay, if they have a jeans order for 100,000 pieces, they used to give us one order for 100,000 pieces. Now they give us 10 orders of 10,000 pieces each in case something changes in the market and they want to tweak the product. So things are actually getting smaller, you know, not bigger. So I think your ability, the ability of suppliers, big and small, you know, will have to deal with a more complex manufacturing situation, you know, and I think that the SMEs in many ways are a bit more agile, you know, than people like us, you know, and we're trying to make ourselves smaller in order to be more agile right now. So I think there are advantages of being, you could be very special, you could be a real specialist, you could be the go-to supplier for a certain category of goods, but what you're going to do is finely segmented. You know, instead of saying that I want to be the biggest apparel manufacturer, you could say that I want to be the biggest embroidery, you know, a supplier out of Hangzhou. Okay, you could still be Hong Yao Zhongyu. You can still have a niche like that, and it could be a very big niche because now maybe you're connected to the globe. You know, now maybe you can find a partner for you who are also SMEs overseas, but you can now find 1,000 of them. You know, so is the, that's the sort of way I would think. You know, in many ways, the technology also democratizes the business. I think that 大公司有大公司做，細公司有細公司做, and both can use the technology. Just think about it, the biggest beneficiary of this new technology is actually the consumer, down to the last unit of consumption, right? They're the biggest, they're most empowered, and China's the most empowered place. Yeah, I think you can't find a more connected, sharper consumer than in China today, much sharper, much faster, much more demanding than the American or the European consumer.
Well, thank you very much, everyone.